All right, back in that time, well, started in the 70s. So Purvis Scott, he was playing bass. Little Monroe Jones was playing guitar. Buddy Ray was playing drums. So at the time, it was just three pieces. So we was working at Lover's Lounge over on 22nd Street and the Rat Trap. Now working down to Pebbles, down on Mission. So I was down in Pebbles, and so this guy, his name was Hank from Black Rap Music. So he came up and said, "Man, I want to sign you up. I like the way you sound." So I signed a little contract. So it been about 5 years gone. Hadn't heard nothing from him. So me and Angel, well, Highway Man had rented this place. And Nate, him and Necktie, Nate was partners. So then, some kind of way, Necktie forced Highway Man out. Highway had put up the money. So Necktie opened the place up, Nate's Green Door. So he running, he wasn't paying his rent. So the place was closed for a while. So the lady across the streets, Miss Rosa, she had a furniture store there, and she owned the building. She wouldn't rent the place to nobody but me. So me and Angel, we rented it and used Necktie Nate license for a while until the license period was up. So then Necktie tried to get Angel to cut me out and they be partners. So we led him on until license time was up. So then Angel, he couldn't get no license. He said, "Well, you can get the license." So I went down, applied for the license and everything. But then he wanted to kind of deal with drugs. I said, "No." I said, "All I got is a name. I can't let you mess that up." So me and him had a falling out because he wanted to let the guy come in and sell drugs. So then I said, "Well, I'm backing out." I went to Miss Rose. I said, "Look, I'm not going to be in that place." She said, "No, I don't want to rent to nobody else but you." So then he said, "Okay, man, we still going to be partners." And he put the license in his brother's name. So we went along with that. So we hung there and worked. And so he said, "Man, you done help me out a lot, sir. I'm going to help you get your record out here." So Jimmy Dawkins, he was coming around. So we hooked up with Jimmy Dawkins, got Willie Kent, Jesse Williams, Larry Taylor, Eddie Burke, and Johnny B. Moore. So we went, we had rehearsal. So we had Big Mojo Elam in there. But we didn't like the way Mojo was playing his bass. So then we got Willie Kent. We went to the studio out there in Melrose Park. Mojo, he got mad because we didn't put him on it. Man, he was mad. So then after we got the record out, then this Hank from Black Rap Music, he wanted to talk about suing me. So Jimmy said, "Well, I'll handle that." So Jimmy talked to some lawyer he had. And I got out of that, and so then me and Jimmy come put it tight. So after we did the whole LP, then Angel got killed in the club that night. I was holding the door, so I had been drinking. I said, "Well, I'm going home." He took the door. No sooner I left out of the door, guy come in and shot him. I'm at home. Next morning, I get him come down there. That's when I find out about it. So then we went to Little Mac Summer. So we took a 45 off the LP. And Little Mac, he gonna blow hard on it. So he had a studio down on Indiana Street. So he had another guy running the studio. So after we did it, and then we brought Lafayette Leak in to play keyboard on it. Then we go down there. Mike Simmons' studio is closed. So what we gonna do? Me and Jimmy went there, and the door was open. So we took a flashlight and went up in there and went through all them tapes and found our master and brought it out. Man, we was up in there around, there wasn't no lights, nothing. But we went through all them tapes, we found that master. So then some guy, Jimmy Noe, was cutting, making records. So this guy, he went in there at night when his boss wasn't there and had to press some 45s up. So we paid for them and we put them out. That's why the 45 didn't have no number on them because the guy had blacked the numbers out because he had sneaked and did. His boss didn't know nothing about it. That's how it started. So I first met Angel Harris through Arlene Brown. He had cut a record. He had put a record out there. He produced one record. The Dead Eye Norris, I think, was playing good talent. So I'd come around and me and him got together and I was out there trying to sing and he was too at the time. So then we come up with the idea of getting this club. So that's how it started. We named it Domino Lounge. So then we started having bands in there. Big Mojo Elam, Willie Kent, you know, around 1980, I think. 79, 80, Roosevelt and Western, around the corner there. The way the studio was, they had the band separate, and they had the harmonica player in there with me, you know, so. Out in Melrose Park, I forget the name of the studio, been so long ago. So we went in there, we did the session one day, and came on out, you know. Jimmy was helping us, but I enjoyed the one put up the money, because the money come out the club, you know. And so we never did put it out, because after he got killed, then. See, what happened, I told him, I said, man, he was letting this guy sell drugs in there. So then he decided he gonna start back in the drug business. I ain't let nobody sell drugs in my place. I'm gonna sell them. So then he started, and when they come looking for this guy, he got what you need, I got it. So one night the police come in there. What I had did, I had cut a section out of the wall. That's why you can move the wall, and you never know it was there. So I put the drugs in behind the wall. So when the police, they couldn't find them. So, so in the back room there, we had a bed in there, you know, and we had a little kitchen and stuff, man. So a lot of nights, I didn't go home. I stayed in the club, you know, that way wouldn't nobody break in. We had a break in one time. So then, but what happened, Hubert had left his amp. They stole Hubert's amplifier. They took everything but my PA. They took it to the door, but they never did take it out. So we fixed it up why they couldn't come in there no more. Yeah, I had Hubert and Little Shorty at the time. Larry Taylor, you know, Eddie Burke, you know. Yeah, well, see, this is how Shorty started playing with Wolf. We go down there and sit in. And Wolf told Shorty, say, you playing good, say, if you ever need a bass player, I'm going to give you a job. That's how Shorty met Wolf, through me. Me and him and Lee Shot Weave and I used to work a lot together. We work at Pepper, and we work at a Woods Lounge over on Fifth Avenue in Kizzy. So one time, Lee Shot, he be at Woods Lounge. I'd be down to Pepper, so I'd do a set of Pepper and run back to Wood, do a set and run back to Pepper. Back in them days, man. And the first time I made some money and went down to Pepper, he paid me $15. Man, I must have counted that money 10 times. I done made some money using my mouth. So I met Pepper through Arlene Brown. She, you know, she was the queen of the West Side back then. You know, she was trying to get everybody in the music. She'd have little sets and she'd have everybody. That's how Big Time Sarah started, through Arlene Brown. But see, this is how Little Mac got involved. Because see, Little Mac, that was her boyfriend at the time. And, you know, Mac had big money then. He was dealing drugs heavy. He had a guard at his door. When you come in the house, you had to be searched. You had one sitting outside. You know, He ride around with briefcases of money, man. You know, he had big money, and so he was spending it on her, you know. And his son, little Lionel Simpson, Arlene produced a record on him because she raised Mike's son. And he got in trouble, you know, he robbed a church out there in Harvey. And I think he killed some people, so he went to jail. So I don't know what happened to him after that, you know. Yeah, so, you know, back then, well, like Artie Blue Boy White, Tyrone Davis, and Mac had their club down there in Indiana. So everybody was flocking to Mac because he had that money, you know. And he had bought a motorhome. He would sit out on the ground like a house. And when you crank it up, it raises up and the wheels come up. And you remember he had that thing advertised on the radio, the best harmonica player in the world, and who could nobody beat him and stuff, you know. He was spending that money, man. He had it, you know. Then he went to jail and he came back out. And then the police caught him again. He was on TV. And he told him, said the law told him to sell drugs to build him a church. He said, at least I wasn't sending it to no kids, so I was sending it to grown people, and they know what they were doing. Some kind of way, he got out of that stuff. Really? Yeah, he was on TV. So the law told him to sell drugs to build him a church. You know, he was ordained minister also. And also, back at that time, a lot of times I had Lee Jackson playing guitar for me. Left Hand Frank, Lucky Lopez, all of them. And one time, this lady was named Jackie, she was playing bass, and another lady, Carol, was playing drums. So that time I had all female band, so I put a wig on Lucky's head. I had a poster tail dragging the female band, so I put a wig on Lucky here. And the place of Dave and Thelma, 4236 West Lake. We played there 4 years on a Thursday night. 4 years. And on Pulaski, 345 South Pulaski, and 308 Mary's Lounge in the Golden Slipper. Well, I played right there in them two clubs for 11 years. Every Sunday night, yeah. And back then, I used to work 6 nights a week on the west side. I had Johnny Little John, Eddie Taylor, all of them. And see what happened. After me and Wolf got tight, when he was in town, he told his boys to come help me out. So that's how Hubert would come and play with me. So that's how I got to know Hubert. We got tight through Wolf, and seeing like Wolf didn't like no drinking. And when he was on break, I would slip Hubert a drink, you know, so we got to be buddies, you know. Wolf was strict. You couldn't smoke on the bandstand. But now when you get off, he buy you whatever you want. And sat there and tell jokes. A lot of people thought he was mean. Now, if he didn't like you, he'd tell you, the wolf don't like you, stay away from the wolf, you know. But me and him always got along, you know, because when his wife was there, his girlfriend was there, I'd speak to him, but I wouldn't go sit at the table with him. But see, a lot of guys, they run up there, and he was jealous, you know. So this guy, Leo Solomon, called himself Little Wolf. So Highwayman, he liked the Highwayman. So, Lily would be there, highway man go up and ask, Wolf, Wolf, who wife that is? Yours or Little Wolf? That made Wolf mad at Little Wolf. And Wolf wouldn't call him up to the van stand. So, me and Highway Man, we had we know we going to sing on Wolf's show, but Little Wolf ain't going to sing because he done made Wolf mad at him. He told Necktie Nate, he used to call himself Little Howling Wolf. And Wolf told him, I'm tired of you going around here using my name. So that's when he went to Necktie Nate. But me and him was all right. I leave, I said, Wolf, I'm gone. come back down here and help me out, you know. So when he was playing, I go down there, he tell me one day this boy gonna take my place, you know. So he, me and him was cool. In 83, you know, the people from the Neverland, they come over and did a documentary, the Hunter Boy Edwards story. So they made a movie just for Dutch TV. So I, when they came over, Ed Taylor and I, we were playing up the blues on Halston. So they came to the fish market. They wanted to find Hunter Boy. Didn't nobody know where Hunter Boy lived but me. So I went out to Hunter Boy's house and got him. And they shot that part of the documentary at the fish market. And I got in that. So then the Mojo Blues Band out of Vienna, Austria, they seen that document. And they came to Chicago and found me. So that's how I started going to Europe. Yeah, you know, so I've been going to Europe ever since 1990. And I'm better known over there now than I am here in the United States. Everywhere I go over there, people know me. I was over in Sweden, and in the library, they got a whole document on me. Picture from 1974, I couldn't believe it. This guy, Tony Loffman, he got a bookstore and a little record store over in Stockholm. And he got a lot of stuff on me, even from the Rat Trap back in 1974. And so I've been blessed, you know, doing fair, you know. Health still halfway good, so I'm blessed.